we have to follow the hadith.
And if it doesn't, why are we? Why are people so adamant about it?
Yeah, that's one of it.
Yeah, okay. The Quran clearly says that we have to follow an extra Quranic material in order to understand the Quran.
Okay, and have you got the evidence for that?
Yeah, chapter 16, verse 44. Okay, do you know the Arabic language? Okay, it states, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وأنزلنا إليك الذكرى لتبين للناس ما نزل إليهم. We have revealed the dhikr, the remembrance upon you, so that you may explain to the people what has been revealed upon them. So there, in this verse, Allah is telling the Prophet, we have revealed the dhikr, the remembrance upon you, so that you may explain to the people what has been revealed upon them. This is not the Quran, this is the explanation of the Quran. Okay, a commentary on the Quran, or the sharh, or tashri' of the Quran. Okay, so this refers to the prophetic tradition, explaining the Quran. Period. It's very clear. There is no escape. People who try to twist it, manipulate it, they cannot do it. Okay? There is no escape. Otherwise, the Quran becomes, in many cases, in chapter 16, Surah 16, verse 44. Okay?
What is that by name? Surah 16.
Nahal. Surah An-Nahl. The bee. Okay? So, the verse is there. It's clearly stating that the Prophet will explain as to what Allah has revealed upon people, or for people, which is the Quran. So, the question is, where is that explanation? That's the question. It's the hadith. There's no other source.
So, you know hadith, yeah?
Word. Yeah.
Did that come like after the revelation of the Quran? Or is that like something that we understand today? Like, you know how Christianity as a word was invented later on to say these are Christians?
Hadith is a Quranic word. It's used in the Quran. Hal ataka hadithu Musa, for example, has the news. So hadith actually means news, reports, information. It can mean a number of different things in different contexts. The technical meaning. Sorry.
Is the word hadith mentioned in the Quran?
Right? Yes. Okay. Yes. Hal ataka hadithu Musa. Okay.
The reports and news of Musa.
Sorry. Yeah. Has the report of Musa or the news of Musa reached you? So, even the technical meaning of the hadith as we understand it today is in the Quran. It's in the Quran. Yes. So hadith, athar, or other words, sunnah, for example, are words used interchangeably by scholars of Islam to explain the same phenomenon, which is the prophetic tradition. In the English language, you call it the prophetic tradition. What the Prophet said, what he agreed to, or what he did. Okay, so we have three ways to know the Prophet and his tradition. What he said, what he did, and what he agreed to. Or what he forbade, if you want to add that. Okay, and that was, of course, explained by his companions, his close companions, diligently. They were very careful in narrating the words of the Prophet. And when they were not too sure that whether they got the actual words right, they would qualify by saying, "Oh, kama qal alayhi salatu salam," that he said something like this. Okay, so we have reports from the Prophet that come from his companions via a very powerful chain of transmission. We have no doubt that the Prophet said those words. Okay, we have no grounds to doubt.
So just simple, basic question: what is the purpose of hadith?
To explain the Quran primarily, to learn how to practice the Quran primarily. Okay, and whatever is not found in the Quran in terms of guidance, that we find in hadith also, right? For example, the Quran doesn't give us the details as to how we do zakat, how we pray in detail, okay, how we do hajj in detail. It is in the hadith. The hadith tells us how to give zakat, on how much amount, how you do it, how often do you do it, because the Quran doesn't tell us. Okay, Quran tells us certain animals are, for example, haram. Okay, and al-bahimatul an'am, the Quranic term is that al-bahimatul an'am are halal. Okay, the Quran doesn't tell us what al-bahimatul an'am is. Quran doesn't tell. We know it's camel, it's cow, it's goat, cattle in general. But can we eat fox? Can we eat lion? Can we eat tigers? Can we eat Muhammad Hijab? Okay.
You know what,
I'm not saying it's so, I'm not saying it's so, so this is a valid question. The Quran gives you a term, it doesn't explain in detail. The detail is in the hadith. From the hadith we know you cannot eat tigers, you cannot eat lions, or you cannot eat bears. These things are haram for you. Okay? So the Quran gives the parameter, and the hadith details it. It clarifies it. Yeah.
You know what I find really beautiful here is that the Prophet Muhammad, he made a prediction. He made a prediction. He says, this is a hadith. He says that he goes, "Ala inni utitu al-kitab wa mithlahu ma'ahu." He goes, and this is a hadith found in Musnad Ahmad, and also it's in other books. He says, "Ala inni utitu al-kitab wa mithlahu ma'ahu." He says, "Certainly I have been given the kitab, the Quran, and something like it with it." And then he says the second time, "Ala inni utitu al-Quran wa mithlahu ma'ahu." I've been given the Quran and something like it with it. And then he goes, "Ala inna yushiku rajulun," that there will be a time where a man, yattaki'u ala irikatihi, he's going to be laying down on his, chair, his reclining chair. Wa yaqul hasbuna kitab Allah, or hasbuna al-Quran, or something like this. Or kama qala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says that this person is going to be, in the end of days, he's going to be sitting on his chair and he's going to say, "Enough for us is the Quran. فَمَا وَجَدْتُمْ فِيهِ مِنْ حَلَالٍ فَحَلِّلُوهُ." Whatever you see inside of this book is halal, then that's halal. وَمَا وَجَدْتُمْ فِيهِ مِنْ حَرَامٍ فَحَرِّمُوهُ. And whatever you find in it, if that is haram, then make it haram. Yeah? So basically the Prophet is, and then obviously he goes into a detail of al-humru al-ahliya, which is like a zebra. He says that, like, for example, this and this and that, the hadith talks about. But the point is, the Prophet predicted that there will be these people, and he cursed those people, and he called them ignorance. Now, the point is, the Prophet Muhammad also told us, "Ala inni utitu al-kitab aw al-Quran wa mithlahu ma'ahu." I was certainly given the Quran and something like it with it. This is very important. What does he mean with something like it with it? This is a very powerful hadith. Wallahi, it's very powerful. It means that he's been given two forms of revelation. The Quran is the word of God, the literal word of God. The hadith is the word of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam through the angel, through God. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he delivers the message and it comes in the speech of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But it's the message, if you like. And the Prophet predicted that at the end of days that there will be these groups that will come, the Quran yun. And he criticized them already himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, you see, this subhanAllah, he says, yushiku rajulun, that it's almost the time where there's going to come a person, yattaki'u ala arikatihi, he's going to be lying down and saying that, you know, the Quran, whatever is halal and haram, the Quran, that's all we need. And obviously this shows, it's a prophecy in and of itself. So the Quraniyun people, they fulfilled the prophecy of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The truth is, if those individuals that steer in that direction are in a very dangerous place, there are two kinds of them. There are those who are sincere and blissfully ignorant. And that's fine, we're all blissfully ignorant of certain things. For those individuals, like Adnan said, that's a beautiful verse he brought up in Surah Al-Nahl, chapter 16, verse 44. That can be referred to. But also, there are those that intentionally reject the hadith, even though it's authentic. And some of the hadith are as authentic as the Quran, in terms of transmission. For example, the hadith, "Man kathaba alayya muta'ammidan falyatabawa maqa'aduhu minan nar." Whoever lies about me intentionally, then let him prepare his seat in the hellfire. This hadith has been narrated according to Tabarani by 42 individuals. It's mutawatir to the highest degree and level. And look, subhanAllah, it's a very important hadith as well. It says, "Man kathaba alayya muta'ammidan falyatabawa maq'aduhu minan nar." Whoever lies about me intentionally. So it's about lying. It's a warning. So it's like, you know, subhanAllah. Having said that, those individuals, those Qur'anis, who, even though the hadith, they know the Prophet said it, really it doesn't sit well in their hearts, the hadith, and therefore they reject the hadith. I believe that those individuals, even if the Prophet was in front of them, or they could hear the Prophet, or they know for sure he said it, they'd still reject that hadith that he said. Therefore, those particular Qur'anis are kuffar, are disbelievers of Islam. Just like, for example, there are Muslims who are munafiqun, they pretend to be Muslim, and they're not really Muslim. Therefore, the rejecting the hadith as a wholesale project is kufr akbar. Yukhrij sahibuhu min al-millah. It's something which takes you out of Islam. Because you will have to reject some of the things which ma'lum bid-deen for the darura, that are necessarily known with the religion. Necessarily known with the religion. Yeah, hay'at al-salah, kayfiyat al-salah, how to do salah, how to do prayers and the same. So, this is a warning really, because the Quran and the hadith, you know, they come hand in hand. It's important now, Islam followers, that they take both. Now, we're not saying all the hadith are correct. We're talking about the sahih hadith, the authentic ones.
Can I ask you a question?
Yes, yes.
So how do we utilize the hadith in our daily lives? Like how, because they're not there just for no reason.
Yes.
How do we utilize it? And what do we get out of it?
Beautiful. So there's two or three different things, yeah? Looking at the Prophet, how he lived his life in the seerah. The thing is about the seerah, is a lot of the hadith are weak in the seerah. A lot of them are weak. So you have to apply a certain amount of criticality in cross-referencing some ahadith. The more you do that, the more you get the thamar, the fruits of doing that. That's number one. Number two, in fiqh, now where we really need hadith to be strong are two things. Aqidah, which is a creed in faith, and number two is fiqh. Fiqh is jurisprudence. Now if you're someone who follows a school of thought, you don't really need to do that. But if you wanna critically understand where you get the information of fiqh, then sometimes it's important to look at the authenticity of hadith, so you know why you're doing certain things. So these are the two main reasons why ahadith are important. Because we want to know what the Prophet did so we can emulate him. The Quran says, you know, إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يَحْبِبُكُمُ اللَّهُ. If you really love Allah, then follow me, i.e. the Prophet, and Allah will love you back. So we want to know how to follow the Prophet. So obviously if there's no template for us to do that, then that verse becomes irrelevant in the present day, in the contemporary period. We say أطيع الله وأطيع الرسول. You know, huh? وما أتاكم الرسول فخذوه وما نهاكم عنه فانتهوا. You know, whatever Allah, whatever the Prophet gave you, then take it. Whatever the Prophet forbade you of, then get rid of it. Then don't do it. So all of these verses will become almost redundant, because obviously, if you say that it only applied to those individuals at that time, it's not correct, because religion is the religion of Islam is for all peoples at all times. Allah says, اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم وأتممت عليكم نعمتي ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا. So he says that today I perfected your religion and I've completed this, your favor upon you, etc. Chapter 5, verse 3. The point being is that if Islam is for all places and all times, then surely the injunctions of the Prophet must be for all places and all times. And if they are, then they must be preserved. You know, and so their preservation is necessary. It's necessary. Does that make sense? Inshallah, brother. Jazakum Allah khairan, man. Alhamdulillah. So now you're okay with the hadith, yeah? Alhamdulillah. Now I'm not saying, by the way, that all of the hadith now are okay, yeah? Even in Sahih Bukhari, even in Sahih Muslim, for academic reasons, some people have criticized the hadith in some of those books. Sahih Muslim, there's mutaba'at. There are some weak hadiths in Sahih Muslim. There are. In Sahih Muslim itself. But generally speaking, as a guide for human beings, I would say Bukhari.
What's the question? Would you reject a hadith if it doesn't fall in line with the Quran?
That is one of the things. So if something, look, the people of hadith, the scholars of hadith have a whole system. And there are some instances where the scholars of hadith look at a hadith and they look at, for example, in Bukhari. Sorry, in Sahih Muslim. Sahih Muslim is a hadith, it's a famous hadith, it's a hadith of Turab. Which it talks about the day was created, that Allah created the earth on this and that, and Adam on Friday. He created Adam on Friday from Turab, Sahih Muslim. But Bukhari himself, he rejects this hadith. It's in Sahih Muslim. Why? And a lot of the reason why they reject it is because it goes against the tartib of Surah Al-Fussilat. It goes against the Quran. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran. So the scholars of hadith, they try and do jam'a al-adillah. They put everything together and they make a they see if there's reconciliation is possible. If reconciliation is not possible, and there's a hadith which goes against the Quran, that's one of the reasons why some people, they reject the hadith. But the scholars do this job. The scholars do this job. And so when someone now comes and does it, now because they feel it's irrational, it's an irrational hadith, because it's outlining some kind of miraculous feature, that's not acceptable. Because Islam is full of miracles, even the Quran is filled with miraculous things. So if you are going to apply that standard on the hadith, surely you should apply it on the Quran as well. Yeah? So the point being is that, yes, there is some kind of truth in what you're saying. We're not saying that the level of the hadith is the same as the level of the Quran. Quran is the word of Allah. Yes? What we're saying is that when the Prophet makes it, when he says something as a ruling, it's the same as when Allah says it, because he's saying it in with Allah's commands. That's what we're saying. In huwa illa wahyun yuha. It's only a revelation that is sent. That's what it says in Surah An-Najm, chapter 53 of the Quran, in the first couple of verses, the third verse. So hey, the point being is that we've got to know. So a crash course guide on how to use the hadith. It's a general rule that Bukhari and Muslim are sahih books. Yes, if when you start doing talabul ilm or whatever, you'll start to find that there are some weak hadith in Sahih Muslim. There are. It's not controversial to say that. There are some weak hadith, like a handful or a dozen of weak hadith in Sahih Muslim. Some have even talked about the weakness in some of the hadith in Sahih Bukhari, like the Mu'allaqat and stuff like that. No problem. There's about 7,000 hadith or 8,000, whatever it is, in hadith in Bukhari. 1,000 of them, or over 1,000 of them, are called Mu'allaqat. Some of those Mu'allaqat are Mawsula and some of them are not Mawsula. Mu'allaqat are hadith that have some weakness in them because the chain is not outlined from beginning to end. It means that the person who's narrating the hadith, in this case Bukhari, hasn't mentioned his sheikh. One of the mu'allaqat which is commonly used, for example, is the hadith of music. You know this hadith, that there's going to be a people that come in the future that will do istihlal of something which is haram. They're going to make something halal, which is something which is haram. For example, I'm giving you examples, right? So the four examples that are given of the Prophet: al-hira, al-harir, al-khamra, al-ma'azif. Al-hira is silk. Is sexual intercourse outside of marriage. Al-harir is silk. Al-khamra is intoxicants. Al-ma'azif is music. So the Prophet said in this hadith, and by the way, this is specific music, like instrumental, whatever, yeah? And there's a whole discussion that I'm not getting involved in right now. So some, for example, Ibn Hazm and Al-Ghazali have said this hadith is not to be taken because it's mu'allaq. It's mu'allaq, meaning that the chain is not outlined fully. Now, Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani al-Fath al-Bari, I'm just giving you one example, so because he's questioning its authenticity. Ibn Hazm is a Zahiri who died, I think, the 600 something AH, yeah? Andalusian scholar. So here, Ibn Hazm said this, and Al-Ghazali, I think, said this in one of his books as well. I'm giving you an example of mu'allaq hadith. Mu'allaq hadith, remember we said, is a hadith that is weak because the chain is not fully complete. In this case, the claim is, Ibn Hazm says, that Bukhari did not mention his sheikh. Bukhari did not mention his sheikh. Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, in Fath al-Bari, for example, he responds to this. He says, Ibn Hazm is wrong. Why? He says, actually, the chain is mawsul. It's actually a linked chain. And he says that you can find the chain with Az-Zarkashi and Hamad ibn Shakir. He gives the names of the people that are basically there. And he says, actually, it's a full chain. The reason why Bukhari did not mention the chain fully is because he expected the academics to do the job. And because it was like there's a whole reason behind it, yeah? It was an academic reason. And he even questioned it. He said that if you say otherwise, you'd be questioning and saying Bukhari is mudallis. I'm going into so many tangents, sorry, I apologize. Let me take a step back. The point is, there is some discussion about these ahadith which are in Bukhari, some of them. And there is some discussion about some of the hadith that are in mutaba'at, it's called mutaba'at, which some of them are weak. But the reason why a Muslim uses them is to support a pre-existing argument. So for example, in the Tabweeb of Muslim, Tabweeb means with the chapter heading of Muslim, in Sahih Muslim, you'll find that, for example, you find like an argument that's made, yeah? So he puts his strongest hadith first, and then after he puts his strongest hadith, Muslim will put another weaker hadith. Now, the weaker hadith has the same information, usually, or very similar information, as the strong hadith he aforementioned. But the reason he puts that is called the mutaba'ah. The reason why he puts that mutaba'ah is only to strengthen the case of the weak, the strong hadith already in place. These are all minute shade details, but the reason why I'm telling you all this is to let you know there's a whole science behind that. Generally speaking, there are different categories of weak hadith. For example, we said mu'allaq, the marasil, which are the mursal hadith, where we said that, so basically when there's a chink in the chain, you have the mu'allaq, which the sheikh is not mentioned, the mursal is when the sahabi is not mentioned. Then you have the mu'adal, when you have two people not mentioned. There's different kinds of weak hadith. The scholars of the hadith, they determine whether a hadith is mursal, whether it's mu'allaq, whether it's mu'adal, whatever it is, and then they tell you it's and then they look at all, they do istiqra. They look at all of the possible variations. You see what I'm saying, brother?
It's a science.
So it's a whole science. So the reason.
Let me ask you a question, yeah? Can you give me like three hadiths, yeah? Like important hadiths or in the 21st century, which we can use or implement in our daily lives? Because you've mentioned a lot about the science of hadith. Three nice or important hadiths that people can implement.
I'll give you 40, yeah? But the reason why I said this is because I'm not going to give it to you, I'm just going to do nakhil of it. So some of the hadith books which are really good for the Muslims to learn is, for example, the 40 hadith of Nawawi. They're very easy to memorize, very nice. It starts with, إِلَّمَ الْعَمَلُ بِالنِّيَّةِ وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَا نَوَى فَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ فَكَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ. Yani, it says that all intentions, all actions are based on intentions. And that's the first hadith. The second hadith of the pillars of Islam, and he outlines 40 hadith. I'm not going to tell you all of them. I'm just going to give you the first two or three, yeah? So the hadith of Jibreel is very important for the Muslims to know. Where the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is asked, Mal Islam? And then he says that, what is it? He says, what is Islam? He said, the Islam is, تَشْهَدَ اللَّهِ إِلَّا إِلَّا مُحَدَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ وَإِقَامُ الصَّلَاةِ وَإِتَاءِ الزَّكَاةِ وَحَجَّ. All of these things, the five pillars. And then he's asked, what is Iman? And تؤمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله واليوم الآخر والقدر خيره وشره خيره وشره. He said to believe in the six pillars of Iman. And then he said, he mentions what the pillars are. And then the last one, he says, وَمَا الْإِحْسَانُ. And the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, أَن تَعْبُدَ اللَّهَ كَأَنَّكَ تَرَى فَإِنْ لَمْ تَكُنْ تَرَاهُ فَإِنَّهُ يَرَاكَ. To worship Allah as if you can see Him, because if you can't see Him, you can see Him. So these are some beautiful ahadith that the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam narrated upon us, and we should always think about. And the 40 ahadith is a good starting place. So just to summarize, because I think I went all over the place and overcomplicated the matter here. Generally speaking, number one, Bukhari and Muslim are the most authentic narrations or books, collections for the Muslims, yeah? Number two, that the scholars of hadith, they have an intricate, sophisticated mechanism of organizing the ahadith. Number three, the authenticity of hadith is most needed in two fields, fiqh and aqidah. Fiqh meaning jurisprudence and Islamic law, and aqidah meaning creed. And number four, that the hadith is, when the Prophet says something in the hadith, yeah, it's as important as if there's a commandment from the Quran. And number five, failure or rejection of hadith is tantamount to kufr akbar, which takes someone outside of Islam.
Jazakumullah khairan. Thank you very much.
What if you were dying from thirst and hunger? Would you give your iman up, your faith up, in order to survive? Probably not. Because you'd rather die in hunger and thirst than give up your religion, right? This is how much we value our faith. It's priceless. Brothers and sisters, let me introduce you to Norway. This is a European country where the vast majority of people have become irreligious. There are 200,000 Muslims of a population of about 5 million, and most of these 200,000 Muslims have no idea how to explain Islam to their non-Muslim friends and neighbors. But that needs to change. Allah sent His messenger to call people to eternal success. And that is why Muslims in Norway are now establishing a masjid and dawah center to enhance the Norwegian dawah.
but they cannot do this alone. We need to support them. If you donate to this cause, you will inshallah reap the rewards of thousands of Muslims coming back to Islam, and many of those will become du'at and invite to Islam. You will share in the reward for all those shahadas and good deeds to come, inshallah. So click the link and donate now and share the video for extra reward.